luckiest guy around. And I told him, I said, this whole thing was worth it just to hear that. Now, perspective is everything. Perspective is everything. We may not know what the future brings. We don't know what the future has in store. We may not be in control of reality. But what we are in control of is what we do with our reality. How we perceive reality. We choose to see the lessons in our life, even in the rain, we're doing true godliness. We're not in control of reality, but we're very much in control of how we perceive reality. And on that note, we're going to begin with the Moda'ani prayer is recited on page...
Translated
right? But some say it means all your money. And the question the rabbis ask is, if it means you're already giving your heart and soul to God, why do you throw in all your money? Right? You already gave your heart and soul. Where does your money come from? The answer is given. They tell a story with Jack Benny. Jack Benny was a famous Jewish comedian who was notoriously cheap. Jack Benny said that one day he was walking in the 1970s in a dark alley in Manhattan, and he feels some cold metal on the back of his head. And the guy says, "Your money or your life?" He says, "I didn't answer." A couple of seconds later, the guy said a little louder, "Your money or your life?" And I didn't answer. A third time, now the guy's getting agitated. He says, "Your money or your life?" He says, "Give me a moment, I'm thinking." Obviously, we wouldn't give our life up for our money. Because what's life worth? What's money worth if you don't have your life? But what we're saying is, we have to remember life, what we prioritize most. What's most important in life? Do we live for our money, or is our money in order for us to live? We never let money get the better of us, but rather money should just inspire us to live a more enhanced life. One final idea on the Shema is it says, all your heart, all your soul, and all your might. The question is, why do we need to say all? Maybe a little bit's good too. Give your heart, soul, and your might. Why do we need for all? The answer is, no one was ever successful by trying a little hard or giving a little bit of it. You want to be successful in life? You got to give it all you got. You got to give it everything you got. Things will only work when you give it 110%. That's how you see success. They tell a story of an anti-Semite who's drinking in a bar. He's a real rabid anti-Semite, not a good one. He notices a Jew sitting at the table nearby and definitely doesn't like it. Bartender, he says, a round of good stuff, a round of the best scotch you got for everyone except for that guy. So everyone except the Jewish man receives a glass of blue label. Anti-Semite looks over at the Jews with a smug grin, but the Jew smiles back. Anti-Semite's not happy. Okay, I got off my game. Bartender, another shot of blue label, but this time throwing a burger for everyone in the bar except for the Jew. Everyone gets another shot and a burger. But again, the Jew schmeichelin, he's smiling. He repeats himself a third round. The Jew's smiling. Not only that, the smile's getting bigger and bigger and bigger. The Jewish man finally looks at them, the anti-Semite, but then he sees his smile, he can't handle it. Furious, anti-Semite says, "We're six shots deep. I've ordered the entire menu. Is this Jew just stupid, or is he pretending to be?" To which the bartender responds, "Oh no, sir, he's the owner." Teddy, you got that, no?
Yeah.
Cool.
That one in advance. Yeah. Anyways, in the Torah reading that we read today, we read all about the sacrifices. On Rosh Hashanah, the Torah reading was a lot more inspiring. On Rosh Hashanah, the Torah reading was about the birth of Isaac, despite all odds. God commanded Isaac to sacrifice, Abraham sacrificed Isaac. It was very inspiring. But then, today, the Torah reading was in providing you with much material. What was it about? Sacrifice. Sacrifices are quite boring. Sprinkling the blood here, this animal, that animal. What's the Jewish takeaway from sacrifice? Anybody have an idea? As a rabbi, I often think I should have become a therapist. 60-70% of what we do is therapy, but we just don't get paid for it. People come, my parents didn't love me, my parents didn't give me enough attention, my brother was this, and got all these childhood sort of stuff. You know what's a new one? My parents loved me too much. They were too good to me. That's a new one. My mother was too smothering. My mother's dinners were too good. This was too, life was too good. And now it's causing me sorrow. You know one thing all our, I'm speaking as a millennial rabbi. You know one thing all our parents have in common, and even if you're a generation older than me, your parents have in common, is they had one word in their lexicon. You know what it was? Sacrifice. They sacrificed for themselves. They came to a new country. They took jobs that they didn't necessarily feel comfortable taking. They drove you to that hockey practice. They sacrificed themselves for us. In life, if you ever want to be successful, or for anybody that has seen success in their life, each and every one of them will tell you that it came with sacrifice. What a sacrifice means?
sacrifice means going out of your comfort zone, going a step further than what you're comfortable doing. The difference in made in life is when you take that extra step, when you go that extra mile. And the Talmud that discusses a rabbi who had the best memory, and what would he do? He would study everything 101 times. The question is, why that? Why 101? 100 is good enough. No, 101. You know what the answer is? Yeah, 100 is the whole study. You know what the hardest one? 92, 83, 76, those were easy. You know what's hard for him? The 101st. He hit 100, but now he's pushing himself to 101. That made all the difference. That made sure he never forgot. Pushing that extra 101st. Sacrifice means going out of your comfort zone, pushing yourself to do something even if you're not comfortable doing so. And oftentimes in life, that's all the difference we need. Before I ask everyone that's not saying Yiskor to walk away for a few moments, I just want to share an idea. I try to come up with new material year after year. Some stuff are worthy of repeating, so I'll repeat them. But one thing that I repeat every year is what I share by Yiskor, because it's worthy of repeating every year. And that is the idea of the Mona Lisa. Regarding the Mona Lisa painting, it was donated to the Louvre Museum in 1898. It was hung in the Louvre from 1898 till 1912. In 1912, it was stolen. Stolen from the Louvre. It took 2 years for them to find the Mona Lisa. In the 2 years that the Mona Lisa was stolen, something crazy happened. More people came to look at the empty space where the Mona Lisa once stood. At the blank space on the wall, more people came to look there than had come in 114 years prior. More people looked at an empty space than came in 114 years to look at the actual thing. They said, I've seen better looking for it. But the Mona Lisa, empty space. Why is that? Why did people come to look at this blank space on the wall? Any ideas?
They didn't believe it.
I believe that's a good answer, but I think it's something else. I think us humans are conditioned to only appreciate. Michael Jackson dies, we didn't listen to his music in 20 years. He dies, number one on the Billboard. Pop Smoke, never heard. No one ever heard of Pop Smoke. Pop Smoke goes, suddenly he's on the top of the Billboard charts. Why? Sometimes we only appreciate our Mona Lisas when they're gone. But if there's one lesson to take away from Yiskor, if there's one takeaway from Yiskor, if there's one takeaway from the Mona Lisa story is, appreciate the Mona Lisas in our life when we still have them. Appreciate the Mona Lisas when we can. Don't wait for the Mona Lisas in our life to be gone before we appreciate them. You have someone in your life, you haven't expressed to them how much they mean to you, stop and tell them how much they mean to you. If there's one thing you take out of everything I said, let that be it. You have someone that doesn't necessarily know how much you love them, tell them how much you love them. You think they already know? We can prove it again. There's no limit to the amount of love that we can show another person. Don't wait for the moment to respond before you do. I didn't think it was don't wait for your Mona Lisas to be gone before you appreciate them. Enjoy the Mona Lisas while you still have them. Take them in while you can. Show appreciation, tell them how much you love them, and be there for them when you still have them. On that note, I ask that whoever's not saying Discord for a parent or a loved one, please don't go too far, because we got like another 5 minutes left of the service, but if you can just move a little bit from those that are saying the Yiskor. The Yiskor is found in the book. Yeah, I got it. Yiskor is found on page 502, 503 in the English. Now, before we start the Yiskor, the question that always comes to mind is, why is Yiskor the only time in which we say that those, in Judaism we don't often send anybody, we never send anybody out of the shul, but the tradition is that those that are not saying Yiskor leave the shul. Why? Oh. The reason why those that are not saying yes or leave the room, this is my idea. I don't know if it's true, I don't know if but. My belief as to why they leave the room is because there's a certain empathy that exists amongst those saying no. When my dad passed, there was a friend of mine who was doing medical research in Vancouver, and he got to know my dad quite well. And he came to New York where my dad was buried for the Shiva, and he gives me a hug. He says, listen, not much for me to tell you, but I know you're studying to be a rabbi. Now you can relate to people in a way you otherwise couldn't have. And it was too soon to hear, and I said, give me my dad back. I don't want to have to relate. I don't want to relate. But I realized that when I came back to the shul where I was a teen rabbi, that he was right. Suddenly people that are fairly cold, unemotional, suddenly they were very friendly. They were saying, you know, I lost my parents at a young age. I lost this one. I lost that one. It's like a camaraderie. It was an empathy that only exists amongst those that have experienced that loss. I tell my wife all the time, I don't want her to have to relate to me. But unless you've experienced loss, you can't relate. So may I ask that those of us that are saying yes, are forever exposed over this year to someone that is experiencing that loss for the first time, be empathetic to that, because we could relate and we can be of great comfort to those people. So we're now going to say Yisker on page 502. If you don't have a book, they're in the box over there. Yisker, you see its first dimension for the parents or for a relative. Feel free to say Yisker at your own pace. 502, 503 in the English, the Yisker.